Galatians 5, 22 and 23 reads this way, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Against such there is no law." In Galatians 5, 22 through 23, we see the fruits of the Spirit. And on Walking with the Word, we're in a 9-lesson series looking at the fruits of the Spirit and how we can live better lives, look at God's Word, and be His people.
Within the pages of God's inspired Word, we learn the truth, which shows us the way that will lead us to heaven. The Church of Christ at East Hill invites you to study with us for the next 30 minutes a portion of the Word of God. Listen now to these encouraging words in song, and then have your Bibles ready for the lesson for today.
Good morning, and thank you so much for tuning in to Walking with the Word. I'm Jonathan Burns, one of the ministers here at the East Hill Church of Christ, and it's a privilege to spend time with you on Walking with the Word. Today we're in a 9-part series talking about the fruits of the Spirit. We can look at those in Galatians 5, 22 and 23 and see that these are the fruits of our lives as we look at God's Word. Today specifically, we're going to look at the fruit of the Spirit, that is peace. Thayer says the word peace that's used here in Galatians 5:22 means a state of tranquility, peace between individuals or harmony and security. Strong says this word peace means by implication one who has peace has quietness and lives his life at rest. Peace is something that helps us understand and helps us know that all things will be okay. And as this morning, as we study in the fruits of the Spirit from Galatians 5, 22 through 23, let us have peace, that we find inside of Scripture. There are a few areas that we'll look at today when we look at the word peace, and I want us to see three specific different areas. I want us to know that peace is optional, peace it is from Jesus, and peace it is forever. Ladies and gentlemen, we can have peace in our lives if we will simply look at God's Word and obey it. Matter of fact, thinking about the word peace, you and I, if looking at the King James Version of the Bible, we'll see that the word peace is used 429 times. It's used 318 times in the Old Testament and 111 times in the New Testament. It's first used in the New Testament in Matthew 10:13. And if the house be worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it be not worthy, let your peace return to you. And it's last used in Revelation 6:4. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given unto him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. The word peace is used in a variety of different times in interesting different ways. And ladies and gentlemen, may we recognize peace is something that we can have. But let's notice, first of all, that peace, it is something that is optional. Three things I want you to see that have to do with the word peace. Number one, the name. Number two, the question. Number three, the opportunity. And in all of these, let's look to the Scriptures to see what peace can do in our lives. Remember, peace is optional. Ladies and gentlemen, in this particular scene, I want you to notice with me the name of peace that comes from Acts 4, verse 12. It's talking about Jesus. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. The first thing I want you to recognize when it comes to peace is we will not find peace in this world. This world is filled with sorrows. This world is filled with hate. And this world is filled with disappointment without Christ. But ladies and gentlemen, there is not a person in this world that cannot be a Christian. You and I can look to God's Word. Matter of fact, we can do that this morning. We can open up the Bible. We can see what the Bible has to say, and we can do one of two different things. We can either choose, number one, to reject what is in the Bible and go after life our own way. Or we, number two, can choose to obey the contents of Scripture, and we can recognize that God speaks through His Holy Word. Only one of those two things will we do. And we need to recognize that it is optional in what name we wear in this world. Acts 4:12 talking about that there's only one name. There's no other name in heaven, given under heaven, among men, whereby we must be saved. This morning, you can be a person who is saved, but you need to know the name that you wear, depending on this world or Christ, it will determine where you are. Not only that, when it comes to the idea of peace being optional, we get to make our choices in this life. Let's ask a question. Now, this question comes from Acts 16:30, and as you're turning there in your Bibles, I want you to recognize, in Acts 16, we have a man who needs to become a Christian. And inside of verse 30, he asked a great question and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" You know, that question is asked in a variety of different forms. It is asked in Acts chapter 2 where they ask men and brethren, "What shall we do?" It was asked inside of the occasion where the Ethiopian eunuch was studying and he asked that someone tell him what he must do. And it's also asked here in Acts 16:30. But I'm telling you this morning that you have the option to ask the question, "What must I do to be saved?" I'm going to give you a list of three things that you need to know when you ask that question. And it has to do with the peace that you have in this life. Number one, when you ask the question, "What must I do to be saved?" you and I need to recognize our own condition. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You're not exempt of needing salvation. I am not exempt of needing salvation. Matter of fact, every person that is a Christian understands the great value of salvation and should understand the great value of the question, "What must I do to be saved?" We also need to recognize, number two, that we need to depend on God. There are a lot of smart people in this world. Matter of fact, I have no problem saying there are many people much smarter than I will ever be. There are people that are much smarter when it comes to the things of this world. We have medical doctors who are vast in their knowledge. We have individuals that are very good at finance and can see how things are going to run. We have individuals that can see infrastructure and other things in this world, and they're very smart in their fields. But ladies and gentlemen, God is the brightest. God is the one that has all the answers to our questions. God is the one that created us. You remember in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God. It was God who was here before we were, and it was God inside of His Word that helps us understand what we must do to be saved. This is where I would like to say, don't listen to me, but listen to the Word. It's in God's Word that we learn what we must do to be saved, and it is in God's Word that we learn where the saved will be for all of eternity. By the way, we also learn where the lost will spend all of eternity. So there is a question that's optional. What must I do to be saved? You need to ask that question in your life, and so do I. Because we need to recognize, if I'm going to have peace, I must have salvation in this life. We will never have peace when we are lost in our sins. Not only in the concept of is it optional, or it is optional, let's notice the opportunity that's right before us. Paul wrote this in 1 Timothy 2:4. Who will have all men to be saved, and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Paul writing about God here and talking about God's Word and what God expects of you and me. By the way, you can study in the Old Testament and you will see with Adam and Eve, you will see with other characters that may be your favorites, those like Noah, Moses, Abraham, Joshua, so many others, that God always told them what they needed to do. God has never left mankind without His knowledge. And you and I live in a time unlike any other. We live in a time, number one, where the Bible is complete. That's not always been true in the world. Matter of fact, more time has been spent in the world, talking about the age of the world, with an incomplete than with a complete set of Scriptures. You and I live in the time to learn about the Old Testament and to see the fruition of it in the New Testament. And you and I also live, number two, in a very great time, because not only do we have print Bibles, but we have great electronic opportunities to study, such as this program today, as we can see things come on the screen. We can hear them said over the radio. We can see the truth that's found into the Scriptures. And Paul wrote this, God who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. You and I need to recognize, number two, in this concept that we're looking at today, not only do we live in the best time, but we can say we live in the most informed time. I don't know how many Bibles I possess. This particular Bible that I have in my hand right now is very important to me. Matter of fact, I leave it in the studio round the clock because it is the Bible that I want to use with this program. It's always in here on this podium. It's very important to me, but it's not the only Bible I have. I have the Bible on my phone. We have the Bible on our computers, and we have a number of paper printed Bibles in our lives. We've never had a greater opportunity to ask the question, what must I do to be saved, but to know what I must do to be saved. Because God is the one who has given us the opportunity, and ladies and gentlemen, it is optional if we want to have peace in this life or if we want to live without God. You and I are going to have to make that determination because we see the name, and that's the name of Jesus. We see the question of peace, that's what must I do? And we see the opportunity that was given to us by God and that all men have this opportunity. The truth is, when it comes to peace, it is optional what we must do in order to have peace that only comes from God. Number two in our program today, talking about the peace that is the fruit of the Spirit. As we turn our lives from this world to following after Jesus, let's notice that this peace, it comes from Jesus. You know, an individual went to visit an elderly woman one time, and she was very badly crippled with arthritis, and she had, at least they thought, much pain. So the lady who went to visit her said, "Do you suffer much?" And she responded, "Yes, but there is no nail here." And she pointed to her hands. And she said, "He had the nails, and I have the peace." She pointed to her head and said, "There are no thorns here. He had the thorns, and I have the peace." she touched her side. And she said, there's no spear here. He had the spear and I have the peace. Isn't it interesting to see, out of the great suffering of Jesus Christ, how much peace we can have in the forgiveness of our sins? The truth is, the peace that we can have in this life and all throughout eternity can only come from Jesus Christ. Listen to this in John chapter 14, verse 27. Jesus said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Jesus wanted us to live at peace. And there's two things I want you to see to help us understand that this peace can come from Jesus. Number one, let's look at the sacrifice from Jesus. And let's look at the result that comes from Jesus. Now, to see the sacrifice, you need to overview in your minds Matthew 27, verses 33 through 56. And in that occasion, you will see Jesus at Golgotha. You will see Jesus who is giving the great sacrifice. And I want you to see just real quickly five events at Golgotha. Number one, you have the place, Matthew 27, 33. And when they were coming to the place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of the skull, it was time for Jesus to be crucified. And they took him to the place. By the way, many people will call this the place of death. You see Jesus in these five actions of crucifixion, or these five things about crucifixion. You also see him in the action, Matthew 27, 35. The first part of the verse, four words, and they crucified him. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a very small depiction of a terrible and unfathomable to us event in this life. I know there are a lot of things in this life that bother us, but we should be bothered that our lives put Jesus upon that cross. And listen to how it's described here, verse 35, and they crucified him. You had the place, you had the action, but you also have the mocking as you go through Matthew 27. Likewise also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and elders, verse 41. Jesus was mocked. He was beaten. He was taken to the place of his death. He was hung upon the cross with those nails, and he was mocked. We don't like to be made fun of, but imagine in the moments of your death, in the hours that led up to your end, a group of people coming publicly to make fun of you. Not only that, he let out a cry. You know, when studying the last hours of Jesus, you've got to look at Matthew, Mark, and Luke. To see the cry, I want you to think about Luke 23, 46. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. It was Jesus who gave out the great cry here in the scenes of the crucifixion. But not only that, it was Jesus who went to the tomb. It was Jesus who went to the tomb, and we read these words. Then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there they shall see me. I wanted you to see something from this sacrifice, the five events from Golgotha. You and I serve a risen Savior. We do not serve a Savior, a God who died, but we serve a God who rose. You see, Jesus in His sacrifice makes it possible for us to have the result. Now, I want us to see the result to know it's from Jesus in Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Probably what I call one of the most important passages in the book of Acts, because it talks about the leadership of the church and it talks about Jesus who gave himself for the church. Listen to what Acts 20, 28 says. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. Ladies and gentlemen, you and I become Christians because we have been purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. The church, ladies and gentlemen, Acts 20, 28, is you and me when we follow after God. So what we see is peace, it is optional. Peace, number two, it comes from Jesus. And peace, number three, it is something that will last forever. There are four things I want you to see to help us understand that peace is forever. Number one, it is to rule. Number two, it is to change. Number three, it is to multiply. And number four, it is to exist. Now, before we get to it is to rule, I want you to recognize something. peace is something that will last forever, but peace is something that must rule in our lives. Listen to Colossians 3:15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. There's something that we need to recognize, and it's the place that peace is to rule. Peace is to rule in our hearts. The biblical heart, the heart that we read about in Scripture, is the heart or the mind. And you and I need to take God's Word, apply it to our lives, and allow that to give us peace. By the way, Colossians 3:15 tells us something that I believe is rather important. He says, "And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which you're also called in one body, and be ye thankful." We can be very thankful today that there is only one church found inside of the New Testament. You study the New Testament from the beginning to the end, and I want you to ask a question. How many churches are there? How many churches did Jesus come to establish? How many churches did Jesus sit and rule over? How many churches is Jesus going to take to eternity? It's only one. There's only one church found inside of the New Testament. And that, ladies and gentlemen, should give us peace. I hope you're starting to understand something as we study peace, how it is forever, and how it is to rule in our lives. Peace comes from God's Word. I want you to answer a question for me, and really it's a question for you. I'll answer it myself. It's a little easy for me to answer because it is my profession. But I want you to answer this as a child of God. And I'll answer this question with this in light. Would I do this if I were not a preacher? Did you study the Bible today? Have you opened up the Bible today? Have you prayed today? Let me tell you, if peace is going to rule in your hearts, you're going to allow God's Word in your life. And in doing so, it will rule in your heart. Peace, ladies and gentlemen, comes from God's Word. Not only that, we recognize that peace, it's forever. It is to forever change me, 2 Timothy 2, verse 22. Paul, writing to young Timothy, says, "Flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart." There's something I recognize about peace. Matter of fact, it's twofold, and you find them both here in verse 22 of 2 Timothy 2. Peace, not only should it exist among the Lord's people, but peace makes us change. Thus Paul writes to him, "Flee also youthful lust, but follow after righteousness and faith and charity and peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart." Here's a beautiful question for you and for me. Is your heart pure? In what you are doing right now, what are your motives? I know some individuals, just as you do, that have impure motives. But do we ever have those same impure motives? Do we ever change things for our better? We've got to recognize that peace, when we are at peace from God's Word, we flee those youthful ideas. We stop trying to become the best and be more important than everybody else. We stop always trying to be right so we can be right, and we start serving. Ladies and gentlemen, if we're going to call or be with them that call on the Lord with a pure heart, I've got to let peace change my life and flee those things that I used to do. You see, peace, it is forever, and it should forever change me. Not only is it something supposed to change me, but it's something that must multiply in my life. 2 Peter 1, 2-3. "Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as His divine power hath given us unto all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him that hath called us unto glory and to virtue." Ladies and gentlemen, grace and peace is to be multiplied through us in the knowledge of God the Father and in the knowledge of God the Son. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to recognize in this life that we should be at peace. I know that you right now, as I am too, sometimes are very concerned about what's happening in our world. Sometimes we're very concerned about what's happening in our nation. Sometimes we're very concerned about what's happening in our local state or even our local communities. But ladies and gentlemen, we need to be also people who are concerned about peace. Has peace multiplied in your life? there's a very big question you can ask right now during the COVID-19 pandemic and all the other problems that we've seen in the year 2020. Has peace multiplied or has fear permeated your heart? You see, peace, it's forever and it should multiply in my heart. Not only that, it is to exist, Romans 15:13. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Ladies and gentlemen, a few things we need to recognize from Romans 15:13. Number one, God is the God of hope, and He fills us with joy, and He fills us in peace. Now listen to this, in believing. Ladies and gentlemen, when we look at God's Word, and when we obey and believe God's Word, we can have peace. Because I can know that God is true. I can know that God, in what He has said, He will do. We're not always that way, are we? We don't always do what we say. We don't always keep our promises, but God always keeps His promise. And through His Word, by the way, which is mentioned in Romans 15:13, the power of the Holy Spirit, you and I can have a peace that exists. No matter what is taking place in our world, peace will always be here if we will yet rely upon the Word of God. You see, peace is to rule. Peace is to change. Peace is to multiply. Peace is to exist. And ladies and gentlemen, peace is something that will last forever. You know, you and I need to understand that peace, it is optional. I get to choose and you get to choose whether we're going to follow after Jesus. I need to recognize that peace, it only comes from Jesus. It's Jesus that died on the cross. It's not you and I who died on the cross. Even though we think about Luke 9:23-25, where Jesus tells us to take up our cross daily, listen to this, and follow Him. By the way, He goes on to ask us the question, what is a man advantage if he gain the whole world and lose himself? You see, peace comes from Jesus, and when we follow Jesus, we'll have peace. But not only that, peace is something that will last forever. Galatians 5:22-23 mentions the fruits of the Spirit. And these are things that we can apply to our lives. They are fruits that we can produce so that we are a people who have peace. I really appreciate today you joining me on Walking with the Word, an opportunity for us to study God's Word together and to recognize that we can obey God and truly have the peace that only He can provide. I want to encourage you today to continue with us in this series and to come back next week as we continue to explore Galatians chapter 5 and the fruits of the Spirit and encourage our lives in the Word.
Thank you for joining us today for our study. If you have questions or comments, feel free to contact us at Post Office Box 329, Pulaski, Tennessee, 38478, or call 363-2777. We hope you will be with us again next Sunday at this same time. And we would be honored to have you in Bible classes at the East Hill Church beginning this morning at 9:30. Worship will follow at 10:30. We hope to see you then.